Rose quartz is a beautiful pink rock. It's often seen in jewelry, like you could see I'm wearing rose quartz earrings right now. And it's especially loved because of its deeper symbolism of loving energy. And I was just trying to solve one question for my research, and that is, why is rose quartz pink? And it actually is not an easy answer. In fact, I don't even know if we know why it's pink. But let's dig into the details. To give some background, rose quartz is also called hyaline quartz, which comes from the word hyalos, meaning glass in Greek. In antiquity, it was referred to as bohemian or Silesian ruby, and it isn't to be confused with pink quartz, which is actually a crystalline version. Rose quartz is actually not crystalline, which I'll dig into in a second. And what I mean by crystalline in this case is that its atoms are not arranged in a periodic lattice. So why is it pink? To answer this question, I want to share how scientists answer this question. First, let's observe this stone with our own eyes, which is our own analytical tool, though it has many limitations. Rose quartz is typically light pink. It can be from a pale pink to a deep reddish pink, and sometimes maybe has orangish tones or purplish tones. It can be slightly to highly turbid, which means that it doesn't have a good clarity, which means it's foggy, you can't see through it. Because it is turbid, we know that when light hits it, it's scattering. That's what creates that glowy white look. So we can say it's turbid because the atoms are not ranged in a periodic lattice. That could cause its paler appearance. When a crystal is more transparent, that just means light is able to pass straight through the crystal. The light passes through the atoms without scattering. Light can pass through only when atoms are arranged in a periodic lattice. So we know rose quartz is not very crystalline because it is highly turbid. But that doesn't explain why it's pink. So maybe knowing where rose quartz is found in the earth can help us understand why it's pink. Massive rose quartz occurs most commonly in granitic pegmatites, and sometimes in hydrothermal veins. Now, quartz is a solid form of silicon dioxide, which consists of one silicon atom and two oxygen atoms. And these silicon dioxide components are arranged in a periodic lattice in quartz. I won't get too deep into quartz right now because that's not what we're discussing. We're talking about rose quartz, which is a type of quartz. So it is mostly consisting of silicon dioxide. But silicon dioxide for a pure quartz crystal is colorless. And when light passes through, if it does scatter, it looks white, not pink. So this still doesn't really answer why rose quartz is pink. So I did some research of my own to figure out why rose quartz is pink and what cutting-edge researchers are saying. So yesterday I spent a lot of time going back through old papers that were published throughout the whole 20th century to figure out why rose quartz is pink. 100 years ago, back in the 1920s, researchers thought that rose quartz was pink because it contained impurities of the element manganese. And then later on, in the 1960s and 1980s, researchers thought, no, it's not manganese, it's titanium impurities. And then researchers in the 1970s and 1980s thought it was because of IVCT, or intervalence charge transfer. IVCT basically is when you have an atom of like a transition metal element, and it has its valence electrons, right? And then when you shine light on it, those photons give those electrons energy. And the electron will transfer between two atoms and absorb part of that energy, but also release part of that light energy. And that light energy release, they were saying, was that red color that gave the rose quartz its pink color. The researchers thought that IVCT was due to the electron transfer either between an interstitial titanium atom and a substitutional titanium atom, or iron and titanium atoms. So by the end of the 20th century, researchers weren't exactly sure why rose quartz was pink. This was just like 20 years ago. In addition to the IVCT theory, scientists thought, well, you know, rose quartz is turbid, which means that there may be other mineral phases present other than just silicon dioxide. Researchers in the 1920s through 1970s also followed this track to try to figure out why rose quartz is pink. And what they found is perhaps it's because of these little needles of rutile that were in the crystalline structure. Rutile is titanium oxide in a tetragonal crystal structure. And what they thought these rutile little micro needles were doing was scattering the light, causing that pink color. They found these tiny needles using Tyndall scattering, which, if you want to look at some really cool science stuff, go Google Tyndall effect. I'm getting a little off track though, so why is rose quartz pink? So by now I think you get part of the picture. Researchers were looking at rose quartz throughout the whole 20th century, trying to figure out why it's pink. Was it due to the impurities? Was it due to IVCT? Was it due to these little rutile needles in the structure? Scientists couldn't really come to a consensus at this point. But luckily, alongside with this research came the development of different analytical and spectroscopic techniques. Material science has had so many advances in instrumentation over the past century. We now have incredibly sophisticated microscopes that scientists in the 1920s could only dream of. We have not only electron microscopes, but we have diffractometers and spectrometers. This means we have better ways to test, confirm, or reject hypotheses, better than we have throughout the whole history of humankind. More recently, because of these analytical tools, scientists are starting to grow a consensus as to why rose quartz is pink. There are three categories of theories as to why rose quartz is pink. Number one is the presence of interstitial or substitutional atoms in the silicon dioxide quartz structure. This relates to those early 1920s scientists who thought it may be manganese or titanium. Second is the charge transfer between pairs of transition metal ions, like titanium or iron, in the crystal structure. This is the IVCT theory. And lastly, third is the presence of mineral inclusions like rutile. So what is it? Why is it pink? So I found these two papers from Caltech. One was published in 2001, one was published in 2002, and these researchers think they figured out the reason why. Are you ready for this? So what these scientists did was collected rose quartz that was mined from all over the world. So from United States and South Dakota, Madagascar, Brazil, Namibia, South Africa. There's lots of rose quartz around the world. And they took this rose quartz and etched it using hydrofluoric acid. Now, hydrofluoric acid is nasty stuff. If that gets on you, you could die. Like, it will cause a blood clot or just, like, dissolve your limb. Not to be too morbid right now. And after etching with hydrofluoric acid or HF, what they found were these fibers. So check out the scanning electron microscopy image of these fibers. They look like hair, right? It's kind of gross to me. A human hair is about 30 microns in diameter. As you can see, these fibers are much, much smaller than that. After doing some chemical analyses on these fibers, they found that they were made out of aluminoborosilicate. And throughout the crystal structure, there were little amounts of titanium and iron substituting the aluminum in this structure. So the scientists took these fibers and compared them with demorterite. Now, demorterite is a mineral, and it actually has like a reddish appearance. And so if these fibers have similar properties to demorterite, perhaps they're similar to demorterite in that they both create a reddish or pinkish color. The scientists used techniques like X-ray diffractometry, scanning electron microscopy, Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy, Raman spectroscopy, and optical absorption spectroscopy. I know all those techniques are a mouthful, but it's a lot of different analytical techniques, right? As I was learning about how the scientists looked at all these techniques to compare demorterite and these fibers, I was like, whoa, like, why are they spending all this time and money on studying this? So the reason they're comparing demorterite to these fibers is because demorterite also has a reddish or pinkish color that it reflects. So light consists of a spectrum of energy. You might have heard Roy G. Biv for red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet. Now each energy of light in the spectrum has a different color. Here is the light spectrum. You can see that around 400 nanometers, that's the wavelength of light, starts becoming like a violet color. And then as you get to larger and larger frequencies, it moves through green around 500 nanometers to orange red around 600 nanometers, and then fades away back into infrared, which is not visible to us. Now here's the optical absorption spectrum measured between demorterite and these fibers. You can see that there is a lot of absorption around 500 nanometers where that peak is, which is where green light is. But the part of the light spectrum that isn't absorbed is around the color where red would be. This tells us that it makes sense that both demorterite and these fibers would reflect red or pink light, creating the pink color. Now, demorterite is also found in the Earth's crust, near where you can find rose quartz. Now, this fiber, the material they found, is very similar to demorterite, but it's not exactly like demorterite. The absorption of light by demorterite is due to IVCT between titanium and iron. In conclusion, the authors used a ton of analytical techniques on these multi-million dollar pieces of equipment to determine that the researchers in the 20th century who were studying this IVCT between iron and titanium were correct in their assumption that this is what's causing rose quartz to be pink. However, the scientists that thought those microneedles of rutile were contributing to the pink color were probably wrong. But the mystery still remains as to how these fibers even form in the first place. So picture the Earth's crust. As these rocks are maybe cooling from their heated forms and solidifying into maybe crystal structures or more amorphous forms, the structure that these materials, these different elements and different compositions turn into is largely due to the temperature and pressure conditions of these rocks. And based on those temperatures and pressures, different elements are going to bond with different elements, and different structures are going to crystallize over other structures. We would expect that these fibers would form like demortarite forms. But demortarite doesn't form in these sillimanite Al2SiO5 crystals. It's a slightly different type of demortarite that makes up these rose fibers. And demortarite wouldn't really form under those temperatures and pressures that exist inside of that sillimanite crystal. So scientists have a theory as to how these fibers form. They think it actually forms exsolution and post-crystallization. What that means is after the sillimanite forms, that demorture-like phase, those fiber phase, separate out of the solid solution. This is like solid materials moving inside of each other. It's pretty crazy. Material science is so fascinating. I love it. And remember, this is just a theory. Research is actually still ongoing. And I'm not specialized in this field in particular. I just was looking as to why rose quartz was pink, found these papers, and was like, oh my goodness, nobody knows what's happening. If you would like to read those papers yourself, check out the links in the description below. I currently don't exactly know why this nonprofit funded this rose quartz research. It couldn't have been cheap, but the discoveries are fascinating. The fact that the color of rose quartz is due to light scattering and reflecting and absorbing off these microfibers that are like hair inside of this crystal structure. And the fact that these fibers only form maybe once that material, the crystal structure, is solidified. And that these fibers are similar to demortarite, but they're unlike any other mineral that's been found today. They're only unique to these quartz-like materials with aluminum, iron, and titanium impurities. Rose quartz is a beautiful mineral, am I right? Humans have appreciated this stone since ancient times. It was prized for its powers of physical beautification. It may have been used as a love token as early as 600 BC. And facial masks of rose quartz were discovered in Egyptian tombs. They were thought by the Egyptians and Romans to clear the complexion and prevent wrinkles. It was also a stone honored by the Tibetan and Oriental cultures. And to this day, it's a major carving stone for China. In pagan or Wiccan practice, rose quartz is tied with the holiday or Sabbath Beltane, which is May Day. Beltane or May Day is on May 1st, which is halfway between spring equinox and summer solstice. This Sabbath celebrates the masculine and feminine energy coming together to make new life. Spiritual communities continue to use rose quartz today. Since rose quartz is pink, it's attributed to be a stone of the heart, or a crystal of unconditional love. Rose quartz is seen to symbolize love of self and others. It carries a soft feminine energy of compassion and peace, nourishment and comfort, and tenderness and healing. People use it to speak directly to the heart chakra, to heal emotional wounds, as well as fears and resentments, and to circulate a divine loving energy throughout the entire aura, reawakening the heart to its own innate love. It provides a deep sense of personal fulfillment and contentment. It allows someone the capacity to truly give and receive love from others. Personally, I find this stone very beautiful, and regardless of how it makes you feel, it makes me feel that loving feeling. A couple of years ago, when I was healing from trauma and learning to love myself, I decided to use rose quartz as a means of reflecting and practicing self-love. I ended up purchasing a few of these rose quartz pendants and gave them not just one to myself, but a couple to my mom as well as some friends. I ended up wearing this pendant daily. And as I would put on this necklace and take off this necklace and just see it or feel it throughout the day, I was reminded to make decisions based on self-love, which to me meant to put myself first and to make decisions that positively served me. And making decisions like this actually changed my life. I would like to say it's all in the power of the rose quartz, which Might be, but I think a lot of that was just in that every day I was using this to remember to act in a certain way. And the repetition built up over time, a bunch of small acts of self-love grew into loving myself even more. Later on, one of my best friends gifted me these rose quartz earrings, which remind me of her and I wear when I want to embrace my own femininity and remind myself to love myself. I want to encourage you to reflect on how rose quartz can positively serve you. When you see it and hold it, does it make you feel happy? Does it make you feel sad? Does it make you feel loved? Does it make you feel feminine? How can you use it to bring up and amplify those emotions in a positive way that serves you positively? Perhaps, like me, you equally find it beautiful and are fascinated by its scientific properties. And perplexed by why someone would spend so much money to research why it's pink. Then again, I guess if I had a lot of money, that would be something I would do with it. Comment below to share how you use rose quartz or how it makes you feel. For more videos on science, crystals, and more, please subscribe to my channel, like this video, and if you really liked it, consider becoming a patron. There's a link below to my Patreon account. Also, like I said earlier, I cited the papers below in the description, so check those out if you want to learn more. There's definitely a lot more information in them aside from what I went through today. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you have a great day. Happy Beltane! Have a very blessed Beltane.